बंदे।
अरे नवा इन्वेंट डॉक्टर थॉमस वर्केन प्रेसिडेंट एसोसिएशन ऑफ पल्मोनोलॉजिस्ट त्रिशूर फॉर द वेलकम एड्रेस और टू डॉक्टर थॉमस वर्केन।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर जोई सर, वार्म गुड इवनिंग टू वन एंड ऑल। टुडे आई वुड लाइक टू गिव यू द कोविड स्टैटिस्टिक्स एज ऑफ टुडे। 568 डेज, 17.4 crores patients worldwide, and 37.4 lakhs death. And majority patients are there with crippled lungs. Actually, this COVID pandemic imposed a triple lockdown in our lungs. It declared containment zone in our gas exchange unit, which is not permitting air to enter, and blood can't go in or go out. So COVID-related pulmonary complications are very crucial in the course of the disease. In this scenario, it's an apt time for APT, Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur, to organize a talk and a panel discussion on COVID-related pulmonary complications in association with the IMA Thrissur branch. First of all, I would like to welcome all the office bearers of IMA Thrissur, President Dr. Joey Manjula, sir, Dr. Indu Dharan sir, Dr. Unni R. Baby, and Dr. Pavanan, and all other office bearers of IMA. I would like to welcome the speaker of the day, Dr. Praveen Watson, who is very good old friend of me and a leading pulmonologist from Aster MedCity, Cochin. And we have a wonderful moderator of APCCM, Dr. Rajesh V, who will mediate today's hot panel discussion. And we are lucky that we got two eminent panelists today. Dr. Amar Jindal, who is a transplant pulmonologist from Yashoda Hospital, Secunderabad. And we have a very dynamic dynamic person, Saurabh Mittal, who is from All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. My sincere welcome to both of them to this our panel discussion. I would like to welcome all the office bearers, current and past, of APT Thrissur, and also all the members of APT and IMA and all the delegates to this wonderful academic evening. Thank you all. Over to Dr. Manjula sir for presidential address.
Thank you, Dr. Thomas Varkan, for your welcome address. Respected State Secretary Dr. P. Gobi Kumar, Association of Pulmonologists, Thrissur President Dr. Thomas Varkan, today's chair Dr. Rajesh V, Chief Consultant Pulmonologist, Rajagiri Hospital, Alwa, and panelist Dr. Praveen Valsalan, Dr. Apar Jindal, and Dr. Saurabh Mittal, and the dignitaries on the Zoom platform, senior leaders from other branches, and guests. A warm good evening to all, and welcome you to all to today's post-COVID-19 CPLA-CME number 6. First of all, let me express our concerns over yesterday's attack on our young brigade of junior doctors who were attacked by the bystanders of a patient who died due to multiple organ disorders and was on dangerously ill list before the last 3 days of his death at the Government Medical College Hospital, Thrissur. Luckily, all these young brigade of doctors ran to their safety, protecting themselves in a locked room. It all happened in the medicine unit headed by Dr. Sriji around 2 to 3 a.m. in the early hours. After seeing a post in the state of health group yesterday in the evening, came to know the incident and contacted Dr. Sajeev Kumar, President, IMA Mulagunthathilavu branch, and inquired about the incident. He gave me a complete narration of the incident and I assured him all the help from our side. This is the third attack on us in a short span of 1.5 months in our Thrissur district. The first one happened against Thrissur Mental Hospital doctor, Dr. Chagni, who was abused by a councillor of Thrissur Corporation, and complaint has been lodged and the case is going on. The second incident happened at Alathur Taluk Hospital against an ENT surgeon, Dr. Asha, who was also bullied in the social media also, who is our Thrissur member. In all incidents, complaints have been given, and let us hope the culprit would be caught and punished. But there is a long but. That's our hope only, and I request our IMA state has to request the government to make healthcare establishments as high security zones like airports and other government institutions. Also, we have to find out a remedial solution to counter these brutal attacks on our colleagues. And in this occasion, let us remind ourselves, it can happen to us or me at any moment. Yes, we have to be extra guarded to protect ourselves. We have conducted 4 mega vaccination camps and could vaccinate around 3,500 doses, 700 plus COVID Covishield, and 2,500 plus Covaxin, including first and second doses. After the first dose of Covaxin, which we gave to 1,150 people, around 7 to 8% got COVID infection, and we had to defer them for 3 months waiting for the second dose. I take this occasion to thank everyone of our colleagues who took trouble and volunteered for the successful conduct of these camps, sacrificing their holidays and spare times for the benefit of our own people. We are now getting geared up for the third wave, expecting to hit in the month of September, October months or so, mainly affecting the population below 18 years. And we have to get them vaccinated at the earliest, and we have to assure all our possible support for the smooth achievement of this purpose of our target before the third wave hits. IMA Thrissur have received requests from many associations and institutions for providing vaccinations to their members. We already are in consultation with the DM of Thrissur, who are very cooperative and helpful to our programs, and without their help, nothing could have possible, helping us providing enough support by way of vaccine and other resources, including manpower. I take this occasion to thank our DMO, Dr. KJ Reena, and her deputies and staff for helping us in this regard. Coming to today's topic, it is on pulmonary complications, and I can assure you, it will definitely will help us in dealing with the situation we are now into. As we all started seeing lots of post-COVID respiratory problems, especially breathlessness, the most common after fatigue and tiredness. With the hope today's session will be a treat to all of us, I invite our State Secretary, Dr. P. Gobikumar, for his address. Over to you, Dr. P. Gobikumar.
Gobi Mutana.
I'm audible now, right?
Yeah.
Hello.
Audible.
Good evening. Respected President of IMA Thrissur, Dr. Joy, President of Pulmonology Society Thrissur, Dr. Thomas Varathan, IMA AMS Chairman Dr. Induderan, Secretary Dr. Umni R. Baby, esteemed faculty and panelists, and my dear members and friends of IMA Thrissur. Again, it's a happy moment for me to join IMA Thrissur branch of CME, because every day or every other day we have a CME and Thrissur branch, and President Joy and Dr. Pavan, Secretary, I'm very enthusiastic in conducting webinars. Now, we have been living with COVID-19 for the last 1.5 years, and we are in the second wave. Maybe we'll go on with the third wave and the fourth wave. But then, definitely, we are faced with a lot of COVID, post-COVID sequelae. Being a respiratory disease, the problem with the lungs is very, very huge. And as rightly pointed out by Dr. Thomas Vadakkan, we have a lockdown in the lungs and containment zones in the lungs. Yes. So I hope this CME will be very helpful to equip with for the general practitioners as well as the specialists to deal with post-COVID sequelae, especially of the pulmonary aspects. Now, when we are dealing with COVID over these months and almost 1.5 years we are being beaten up right and left all over the country. You have many incidences just like in Assam and other states, and we have a few incidences narrated by Dr. Joy Manjula. Again, other incidences from Mavelikara, from Idukki and other states. And again, we are forced to have severe or very very effective strike against this menace. And on 18th, we have a national protest day. We have a meeting with the national president and national secretary on the 10th. I'll be sending the link to you, to each one of you. You are requested to attend that meeting in the evening on 10th of this month with the national president and national secretary to have the arrangements for the 18th. So definitely, as we are treating the patients, but we have to protect ourselves, not only from the virus, but the hooligans as well. So for that purpose, we'll be we are giving very much importance for all the activities of protesting against this violence and pressurizing the government to have a safe zone for the hospitals and healthcare institutions. And once again, congratulating the Thrissur IMA, the IMA-AMS Thrissur, and the Pulmonology Society. I conclude. Thank you, Jai Hind, Jai Hind.
Thank you, Dr. Gopi Kumar, for your address. Now I invite Dr. R. Indudharan, Chairman, IMA, AMS Thrissur, for his address. Over to you, Dr. Indudharan. Dr. Indudharan, are you around? Hello?
Thank you, Joy sir. Anyway, welcome. Congratulations to Team Thrissur. Anyway, your CMEs are getting more and more popular. Till now, I think 127 members have joined our CME. And anyway, this is a very relevant topic. Ippo paranamari pulmonologists are the avarana ippo taram. Ippo definitely we are eager to hear. We have stalwarts pulmonologists from all over the world, and I think they are directly in action in COVID duty and post COVID, because now what we are seeing is many post COVID negative patients are getting pulmonary complications. So definitely we are all eager to hear from them, and we have got a very good speakers lined up today. So wishing all the best for today's CME. Thank you,
Dr. Jain, for your address. Now I invite Dr. Undiyar Bedi, convener, IMA-AMS Thrissur, for the introduction of the chair and further proceedings. Over to you, Dr. Lee.
Good evening, sir. Thank you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, audible.
Hello. Yeah, okay. Many thank you and good evening to one and all. It is my pleasure in inviting you all for this CME. We have been conducting a post-COVID sequelae CME. This is our sixth program. And it is a pleasure in joining with my own organization, Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur, in conducting the pulmonary complications of the post-COVID. complications that we are going to deal with. We have got an excellent panel today, and to chair the panel, we have none other than Dr. Rajesh. I don't think Rajesh sir needs any introduction. Anyway, to anybody who doesn't know Dr. Rajesh sir, he is a chief consultant pulmonology and the head of the department of pulmonology department at Rajagiri Hospital at Alua. He has completed his MBBS from Government Medical College, Kottayam. He did his MD from Goa Medical College, and he passed his DNB with gold medal in the year 2007. He has also completed his fellowship in critical care medicine. He has been he's a well-known international, national and zonal level speaker, and also organized many national and international conferences. He is also an academician, a teacher, an organizer, and a best clinician that is available. So over to Rajesh sir. Welcome you, sir, for this CME. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Unni, and thank you very much for those kind words, and I felt flattered anyway. At the outset, let me thank the IMA AMS Thrissur and the APT Thrissur, one of the very formidable pulmonology branches of the Kerala state, for giving us this opportunity. And it's a very relevant and probably the star topic, that is, we have the acute COVID, but then the complications don't stop there. We do have a long period of post COVID or long COVID or recent COVID lung complications. And to enlighten us, we have a very, very formidable panel of experts. Shall start introducing them. Dr. Praveen Valsalan, again, to the pulmonologists of Kerala and South India, I don't think Dr. Praveen Valsalan needs any introduction. But he did his MBBS and MD respiratory medicine from the prestigious JIPMER. And he currently serves as the lead consultant pulmonologist at Aster Medicity Cochin. My association with Dr. Praveen spans for more than a decade, where we have worked in very close proximity for various academic and other forums. He is a hardcore interventional pulmonologist, and the second area of his interest will be sleep medicine. He also is a recipient of the Young Pulmonologist Appreciation Award by the Academy of Pulmonology and Critical Care Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Praveen, to our panel. And the second name that I have to share with you is none other than Dr. Apar Jindal. Now, in pulmonology field, not only in India, even beyond India, Dr. Apar Jindal is synonymous with lung transplantation, and lung transplantation is synonymous with Dr. Apar Jindal. So he currently serves as director and advanced lung failure and transplant at Yashoda Hospital, Hyderabad. He did his MBBS from Karnataka and his MD respiratory medicine from Chettinad Medical College in Chennai. And he has a long list of various fellowships that he did in lung transplant from various prestigious institutes across the globe. And he has a significant experience in lung transplantation for post-COVID lung complications also. So welcome, Dr. Abar. And the third gentleman who actually adorns this panel is Dr. Saurabh Mittal. He is an assistant professor of pulmonary medicine at the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. He did his MD and DM in respiratory medicine, and he is currently serves as the assistant professor, a very formidable, young, enthusiastic and dynamic pulmonologist of the country, who has almost 100 publications to his credit. So with this introduction, we will move to the panel discussion per se. For the sake of time, we have made it into around 9 questions, 3 questions to each panel, where everyone will have a short discussion. And if anyone wants to intervene, just put something in the chat box so that we can include that particular question. And if time permits, we can even give time for the particular person to share his doubts through the mic. So we'll start off with Dr. Praveen. Praveen, as we previously mentioned, we have the acute COVID, we have the COVID-related respiratory failure, we have the pneumonia, we have the inflammatory state, but then that imperceptibly merges with the post-COVID lung failure and lung complications. So what would be the ideal or optimal term for the lung sequelae of COVID, whether it is long COVID or post-COVID or recent COVID or whatever be it, and what is the pathogenesis and pathology of lung changes after the acute viral replication has halted?
Okay. An extremely pertinent question. The term, if you look at the ideal term to say for this sequelae, the lung sequelae of COVID is probably a little bit difficult. So instead of going directly into that, let me just go through what happened. What do we see as a sequelae in this COVID, sequelae of this COVID patient? So when we look at the initial studies to look at the time period, the time course of the lung changes, what we see is the maximum lung involvement is at somewhere around 10 to 12 days. But if you see the studies which looked into a long follow up those COVIDs, like say 6 months over the time, what is seen is, in fact, 1/3 of the patient, in fact, though we are talking of those patients who had severe COVID pneumonia, those patients, 1/3 of the patient completely resolves. The another 1/3, in fact, has some sort of residual ground loss or pacification or interstitial thickening. And the other 1/3 will have some amount of the so-called the fibrosis-like changes, the fibrotic changes. And by which I mean is the traction bronchiectasis. What we commonly see is parenchymal bands or the so-called, the microcystic honeycombing. So it's as opposed to the classical, the IPF that we see, the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, which is our, the baseline, the fibrotic disease that we talk of. So as opposed to that, the classical honeycombing is not seen in these most of these patients. What we see is primarily the traction bronchiectasis, which is basically the scarring of the lung. So it's the end result. So that is how, in fact, I convey with my patient is that your lung has scarred, which most of the lay people actually, they can easily understand. So even in the pathology, what we see most of the time is like after this acute COVID, we have the stage of viremia and then the stage of inflammation where all this havoc actually happened. So the pathology, in fact, if you see the pathophysiology, more this stage of inflammation is mostly because of the multiple cytokines and the inflammatory markers, primarily the interleukins and the TNF alpha factors that is being produced, and thus, in fact, the aim of this is to fight off the virus, but this also causes significant inflammation, which is trying to fight off the virus. But, and these host cell undergoes apoptosis, and it releases virus that again infects the other cells. So the pathology, in fact, in these poses is quite similar to the other viral infection, like say the previous coronavirus, like SARS and MERS, or most of the time. So that's primarily the diffuse organizing damage, the DAD, that is the diffuse alveolar damage, or the severe fibrotic organizing pneumonia pattern, especially with some amount of this fibrosis, which I mentioned, that is primarily with some amount of microcystic honeycombing that is seen primarily in the pathological specimens. But the autopsy also has shown that there are some things that is striking in this is the significant amount of the thromboembolic features that is also seen in these patients. The thromboembolic, especially in the central or in the subsegmental areas of the lung. So that is one thing that is strikingly different from probably the other viral, the corona, as well as the H1N1 ARDS that we have seen in the previous years. So to say that it's the long haul COVID, or those so-called the long COVID syndrome, probably encompasses the whole scenario, including the symptomatology that includes even the multi-system inflammatory syndrome. But to say that to describe a sequelae that happens in the lung, probably the best way to say is it's basically the post the COVID sequelae, the post COVID. It's difficult to say exactly the fibrosis, but to say that post COVID lung post infectious lung fibrosis or something like that.
Thank you, Praveen. Very happily put. So probably I can say that the terminology is not important. realizing and the tackling would be more important. And probably the pathology that happens is a combination of organizing pneumonia, a significant degree of thrombosis and associated vasculopathy, and if severe enough, probably fibrosis and traction bronchiectasis.
Rajesh, can I add something here?
Yeah.
So, you know, as Dr. Praveen beautifully brought out the autopsy findings, so we also have good experience with the explant biopsies. The I've done about 26 transplants for post-COVID patients now. There were a few other characteristic points that we saw, and that actually brings out some difference from the other viral illnesses. So some of the points, very pertinent things that we saw, was that it's not only a thromboembolic complication that we are seeing, but also a perivascular fibrosis. And I think that is one of the reasons why hypoxia is so predominant in these diseases. Even the response, the hypoxic response of the vessels is actually absent because of this fibrotic changes around the vessels, and not only the, you know, microthrombo which are present inside the vessels. Along with that, depletion of the lymphocytes, they're completely devoid of lymphoid follicles. The cellularity is absent in the lymph nodes, which we see in the mediastinal area during the explant biopsies. And this correlates very, very well to, you know, the sequestration of this lymphocytes inside the lungs. Now, the third very important point, and this is now beyond the lungs, is when we looked at electron microscopy of these images, there is widespread damage. And the major point of destruction here was mitochondrial injury. So we see that these patients have extreme weakness. They're in a high catabolic state. And that clearly resonates with the electron microscopic changes. There is not only damage to the pneumocytes where surfactant, lamellae and everything is lost, but there is very severe depletion of mitochondria within the cells. So that adds to the catabolism. And as it was out in the news today also, and so many reports have been coming, these are also seen, there is also seen destruction of the gray cells and also of the axonic connections, the neuromuscular junction. There is depletion of these junctions in these sites. So overall, the disease is not just limited to the lungs. More and more we are getting to know, the more and more information we are seeing, we can see that it is actually a multisystemic disorder, which is involving other areas as well, other than just producing, you know, fibrosis of the lung as a complication, as a sequelae to it.
So if I can just translate Dr. Abbar's words to simpler terms for the IME office bearers. So there is a significant degree of vasculopathy and vascular fibrosis. So the baseline hypoxic vasoconstriction is not possible because of this vascular fibrosis. And that actually worsens the hypoxemia along with mitochondrial changes and increased energy demands. So it pass on to the next question to Dr. Saurabh. All of us are seeing a lot of patients with extensive COVID pneumonia, ARDS, critically ill, needing HFNC, NIV, ventilation, etc. So Dr. Saurabh, in your practice, what proportion of your patients with respiratory failure and COVID pneumonia have residual lung shadows and need supplemental oxygen when they are discharged home? And I suppose, is this relation to persistent changes associated with disease severity? Dr. Saurabh.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. So the first point is the need for oxygen at discharge and the persistent radiological shadows. So a lot of it will depend upon the center you work in. So we tend to send a lot of patients on oxygen because of being a government sector. We have to kind of discharge patients a little earlier than probably from another center. So I would say the patients who required NIV ventilator or NIV or HFNC, their average hospital stays 3 to 4 weeks. And almost 40% of them go home on some degree of support with low flow oxygen or 3 to 4 liters of oxygen. Some patients have gone on 8 to 9 liters or 10 liters of oxygen. So, most of these patients tend to improve with time, obviously. So, I would keep the figure somewhere around 40 to 50%. But if you have a little prolonged hospital stay for some patients, if you have give them time to recover in the hospital, like at 4 weeks, 5-6 weeks, so the figure may significantly come down, because at 6 weeks, you see a lot of these patients tend to show a marked improvement. Regarding the degree of patients in our practice or the international data suggests, so they also suggest that a significant degree of patients may go home on oxygen therapy from the hospital. Doctor, you are not audible, Dr. Rajesh.
Dr. Rajesh, you are mute.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Savadab. So the exact proportion of patients who actually require oxygen therapy at discharge would depend upon the setup of the patient. If you are in a setting where you need to really clear beds fast, I think most of the hospitals are in that state now in India.
Yeah.
So around 30-40% of them actually go home on oxygen. That's what I could get. And it's probably related to the severity of disease per se.
Yeah.
We will get fast into one or two queries from the audience also. There is one query, what's the probable cause of respirable ground glass shadows that persist after 1 month? So as Dr. Rabar clearly pointed out, there is some degree of organizing pneumonia. There is some degree of vasculopathy and all those things, some degree of fibrosis and all those things. So most of them can cause shadows. And how long does it take for the clearance of ground glass shadows? It's an individual case, I suppose, but on an average 2 to 3 months, a significant chunk of shadows do disappear. And probably we delay doing a pulmonary function test by at least 1 month for making a diagnosis of restriction. Okay. Now moving to Dr. Abar. Dr. Abar, what are the risk factors, both pre-existing as well as COVID-19 related risk factors for persistent lung abnormalities after acute COVID-19? And do you feel that the severity of persistent abnormalities or hypoxia is better in those who have been initiated antivirals earlier, independent of the severity of disease?
So I think this is a very difficult question that you're putting to me, Dr. Rajesh. So there is hardly any data which is available. Correct. Over here. So I think
maybe you can just share your perceived feeling.
The answer to this question is going to be very anecdotal over here. So when it comes to, you know, typing the patient into the risk factors and guessing that who of them will get into severe COVID, who of them will escape the disease mildly, I really don't have an answer to that. We've all been harping upon uncontrolled diabetes and uncontrolled hypertension as being risk factors for developing severe disease. But all of us have seen in our practice, you know, really bad diabetics and really bad hypertensives also going through mild disease and asymptomatic phases. And young, you know, 25, 26 year old boys who've been fit, healthy, athletic, ending up on the ventilator with severe ARDS. So I think there is very little information available to understand and to predict that who will enter into what phase. Now, as far as the question of starting antivirals early goes, I am a strong, you know, proponent of that. I think antivirals, if at all work, have a role very early on into the disease. Once you've already hit the phase of hypoxemia, once you've already hit the phase where you are 7 days or 8 days into the disease, I don't think antivirals are of any use at that point of time. Because now the viral replication is already coming to a stage where it is about to end, and it is the cytokine injury and the effects of this injury which we are seeing in the lung which are creating the problem, and it is not the active replication of the virus. So definitely the answer to that would be that if at all you have to use antivirals, it has to be at the early stage of the disease, irrespective of whether or not you really need to treat the patient. So that is a decision that I think the clinician needs to take, depending upon the patient population he's serving, depending upon the age of the patient, depending upon the background of the patient in respect to the comorbidities. And yes, the only factors that we can put is that people who have coexisting lung disorders, although we've not seen too much of, you know, flare-ups of TB or asthma or COPD or worsenings of ILD in these cases, but still these patients, when they get COVID, they tend to have more severe reaction. Then patients who've got uncontrolled cardiac disorders, or I would again still would like to believe that uncontrolled diabetes would be a risk factor for patients to develop severe ARDS or severe COVID as compared to healthy patients who've got a robust immune system and would help ward off against the development of severe disease. These are the ones who would end up being asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic and escape.
Okay. So from Dr. Abbas's word, what I could get was, you know, the predictors are not that very well defined, and many of the real life scenarios defy predictions. We predict that some patients might do bad, but they actually do good. And if at all you start antivirals, start them early. I think that's a very loud and clear message that all of us want to give. If you want to start antivirals, again, yes, there is some degree of controversy, but most of us would go for that. But do start it early. No point in starting it at a phase where the inflammatory stage has really established. Okay. A couple of comments from the, or rather queries from the audience. I think when should antifib? I think that we are answering in another major question. What are the indications for steroid therapy in COVID? Does anyone want to take that? I think.
You know, I'd like to take a stab at it and say that the first onset of hypoxemia, if your fever is high, 103 degrees Fahrenheit or something like that, if your fever is persisting beyond 3 to 4 days, I think that is the time to start steroid. We can't wait for, you know, hypoxia to establish or CT changes to come. These are markers of inflammation. If you're seeing inflammation, anti-inflammatory meds have to be used right at that point of time. So I would definitely would want to start steroids, not on the basis of a time scale, but depending upon the symptom severity and depending upon the clinical condition that the patient is showing me.
I think, can I just add to it?
If
I say, as Dr. Abbas said, the ideal time is when the inflammation starts. So a person who is on home quarantine, to say that when his inflammation is starting, probably what we should tell them is like, when the cough started increasing significantly, or as he rightly pointed out, a persistent fever. And we also included, it's not just the desaturation, but if there is an early exercise desaturation also, probably it's an early indicator. So if the patient walks and he starts desaturating inside the home itself, probably when he is in quarantine, and that I think that's a place where we can, you know, advise them to start on steroids. So when the patient worsens, so instead of the timeline, when the person worsens, that will be the ideal time. And so I think that's something that we need to stress upon this, especially because most of our patients nowadays, they are on home quarantine, and they'll reach the healthcare facility sometimes a bit late. So that's something that we can, avoid them and start them on steroids a little bit earlier, tad earlier.
So the message is from Dr. Abhar and Dr. Praveen is very clear that act early. Yes, it might lead to some overtreatments, but overtreatment is definitely better than undertreatment. One query from the delegates: when do you advise PFT in a post-COVID patient? Dr. Saurabh, you have any take on that?
Yeah. So probably we'll be discussing it forward also. But a patient who is recovering from COVID, at least a 4 weeks gap should be given. So I have seen people getting PFTs after 1 week from recovery, 3 days from recovery, and being told that they are having restrictive lung disease. So there should be, if you look at the guidelines, the UK NICE guidelines, they wait for 12 weeks because there's a time that when lungs would continue to improve and you may not need to intervene. But you know, the health system varies from country to country or the place to place. What I would suggest, at least a 4 weeks gap should be there. It may be to 6 weeks, 8 weeks, depending upon the symptoms. If somebody has symptoms at the end of 4 weeks, I would definitely would like to do a PFT, but not before, at least after 4 weeks from recovery, which is like 6 weeks from the onset of illness. And this can go up to 6 to 12 weeks. And depending upon patient symptom, we may need to perform a chest radiograph or a PFT or a 6-minute walk test. So all those will be individualized, but around 6 weeks from the onset of illness, that would be the first time we should perform a PFT.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. And next query is to Dr. Praveen. Praveen, what will be the natural cause of clinical symptoms, functional abnormalities, and radiological changes that persist at the end of COVID pneumonia and ARDS? And when would you think of specific therapeutic interventions, that is targeted pharmacological agents in these cases?
Okay, we have seen a lot of, most of our patients, most of us would have seen a lot of COVID patients. So what we generally see is once these SARS-CoV-2 enter into the respiratory tract, it binds to the ACE2 receptors and enter into the, especially which is much more prevalent in the nasal epithelial cells. So it starts with an initial asymptomatic phase, and this will be followed by a stage where the starts replicating. That's the time when, slowly starts entering into the lower respiratory tract. And this replication produces more viral nucleic and all those, the inflammatory mediator. So this, how one's body reacts to this virus, it all depends on the person to person. Most of the patients, say over 80% of the patients do not progress beyond the stage. The 20% of the patients enters the so-called the progressive stage, where there is a stage of pneumonia and ARDS. Those patients who had pneumonia, in fact, majority of these patients do recover. Only a minuscule number, say 1 to 3% of the patient might require an ICU admission or a ventilation. So that's a very small subset. But what we have seen is that this very small subset of patients can have a very severe disease, and then it can have its own long-term complications. So probably the functional abnormalities that we see in most of these patients, in fact, there are a lot of studies on studies on the lung function abnormalities that we see in these COVID patients. What is seen is mostly the restrictive abnormalities, and that is seen even after a 6 months period. So as Dr. Saurabh has rightly put it, we don't need to do this the PFTs early to see this abnormalities, because it will take a long period. The lung healing is a long process. That is what I generally tell the patient. So at least 1 month later, we can do the first PFT to see the abnormalities that is seen. And probably in the later stage, the most common abnormality that we will be found is the reduction in the DLCO, which actually correlates with what Dr. Abhar has mentioned. That is the peribronchiola, the peribronchial, and the perivascular fibrosis that is seen in these patients. Similarly, it also correlates with the 6-minute walk test reduction. So when to use this is basically because of this fibrosis that is seen in these patients. So when to use the so-called, before that, probably the one thing that can help in these patients is the early rehabilitation, the pulmonary rehabilitation. So early pulmonary rehabilitation do help in these patients. The earlier you start, especially once the patient symptoms has come down and once the patient becomes stable, the earlier we start, the better the outcomes are. The earlier probably we will be wean him off the oxygen and he can come back to an earlier life. So pulmonary rehabilitation plays a very important role in treating this lung changes that we see. The second is what we all have heard, the so-called the targeted treatment, what Dr. Rajesh was, the so-called the antifibrotic therapy. So the rationale of using the antifibrotic therapy is based on the fibrosis that we have seen. I mean, or rather, the base is the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. The treatment on the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, which is a typical fibrosis, where we have a significant amount of the honeycombing, significant amount of traction bronchiectasis, and it's a progressive disease. By definition, it's a progressive disease. Whereas in COVID, it's not exactly a progressive disease, because once the inciting agent is over, the classical progression does not happen. There is some amount of progression over the time, which is partly because of the inflammatory mediators that is there in the person's body. But otherwise, unlike the classical IPF, which is not a typical progressive disease, but still we all have tried either the pirfenidone or the nintedanib, which are the two antifibrotics that have been approved for the use. Of course, we know that the pirfenidone has significant antifibrotic and anti-inflammatory, as well as a lot of pleiotropic properties, which do help in these patients. It also, even nintedanib also tries to inhibit, the IL-6, which we try to inhibit with the tocilizumab. So it definitely have some role. So the query that always happens is, when do we start on an antifibrotic therapy? Probably once we see that the patient has patient has significant disease and they are going in for a sort of an fibrosis, or they are going in for a long haul stay. Probably those are the patients that might benefit from fibrosis. But treating them with antifibrotic, there is no guarantee that the fibrosis will not develop, because none of the studies have actually clearly shown that these drugs are really beneficial. So it's a win-win situation. But then it has its own complications also, like say both the drugs has hepatotoxicity. It's difficult, theoretically at least, it is difficult to give nintedanib along with the anticoagulation, because of the risk of producing bleeding, et cetera, so. But then those patients who are on, who are not becoming better, then it's a win-win situation. So you can probably, go ahead with the antifibrotics. But then, probably one more thing that probably is coming in a big way, I think Dr. Abhar or Dr. Saurabh can explain, like say the stem cell therapy.
Okay, I think we will just dwell in this aspect for another 2 to 3 minutes, because this is one major area. Stem cell, I think we have a separate question on that. So antifibrotics, rationale, evidence, when to start, how to proceed. I think I'll have opinion from both Dr. Abbar as well as Dr. Savara, because probably that is the gist of today's panel discussion. Dr. Abbar.
I think Praveen has covered it very well. Antifibrotics, there literally evidence is lacking. So again, it is just on the basis of understanding that this is something that can prevent the fibrosis from happening. Now, the question is whether we start when we start seeing the reticulocytosis, when we start seeing traction bronchiectasis, which would imply that the fibrosis has already happened. Now, from whatever mechanism we know, these drugs are not really antifibrotics. I think it's a misnomer to call them antifibrotics. So literally speaking, if you look at the other trials also, they're just slowing down the loss in the FVC, right? So whether or not they can stop the process of fibrosis is again just a thought process that is being put forward over here. So if at all they have to be used, now which to use, whether pirfenidone or nintedanib, as he's rightly brought out, I think with anticoagulation, nintedanib does have its own bad effect. And especially we've seen when patients are on ECMO, a lot of the patients have profuse bleedings if they're on nintedanib therapy. But then again, the good thing is with nintedanib, you can come up to the therapeutic dose. You can start with the dose of 150 twice a day directly, as compared to pirfenidone, where you would need to build up the dose. And you never know whether you will be able to hit the targeted dose at all or not in these patients, whether they will give you that much time or not. So I would rather, if I have to start, I would start whenever I'm starting to seeing an ARDS picture developing, whenever I'm seeing a patient who's stuck, who's not improving the way we would like to see the patient improve. If we've tried antiviral therapy, if we've tried steroids and it is not working, I would upfront add the antifibrotic if I have to, rather than wait to see CT changes and then add. Because fibrosis, once developed, we know it cannot be reversed. So the whole idea is to prevent that fibrosis from developing. So adding them upfront, I think, would be more important. Now, the question is how long to continue after that. Now, in typical IPF, where again, Praveen has brought up, it's a progressive fibrosis. But this is something where we don't know whether it's going to progress or not. And in the cases that we've followed up since last March or last April, we've seen that the degree of fibrosis that ends at the, you know, duration of 3 months or 4 months, it stays throughout, you know, about that. So is it, so the question really is that do we stop the antifibrotic therapy after that, or do we still continue it to prevent it from further growth? I think we need much more data to be able to answer that question concretely. Saurabh, your views maybe.
Thank you, Dr. Aparsa. So I would like to add a few more things to this problem of antifibrotics and post-COVID sequelae. So first thing is probably the use of steroids in the correct dosage for the correct duration. So if you go to a patient who is like active COVID 2 weeks into illness, hypoxemic ARDS, intubated or high flow nasal cannula, at 2 weeks or 3 weeks of illness, they are usually on some degree of steroids, which is usually methylprednisolone in the dose of 40 milligrams twice daily or dexamethasone in dose of 10 milligrams to 20 milligrams. So how do you go about such patients? So if a patient who is very high oxygen requirement with active COVID on high dose steroids and not improving, that is one scenario at 3 weeks, 4 weeks, who are not at all showing any improvement. So those are the desperate situations, which Dr. Abbasar also said, that those are the desperate situations we may give a trial of antifibrotic. But if you ask my personal opinion, I tend not to give it, for the reason being that that these are the drugs which don't work on an acute setting. They work very slow. They are slow in onset, slow, and you really don't expect them to reverse the hypoxemia which is happening in the last 3 weeks or 4 weeks, that in 2 weeks your patient would stand up and would be off oxygen. So one thing is that their action is very slow, and it takes months for them to actually show their benefit in the setting which we know that is the progressive fibrosing ILDs or the IPFs. Secondly, these patients a lot of times are on multiple antibiotics, antifungals, on ICU, taking RT-feeds and all. A lot of them develop diarrhea. The experience I would say, an ICU patient, once you start them on nintedanib, almost everybody will develop diarrhea. So a patient who is too sick, I prefer not to give any of the antifibrotic. One thing is, if you have to give, the nintedanib is a better choice because it can be given in the correct dosage at the correct time rather than waiting for pirfenidone to escalate the dose. Secondly, you have a patient who is like 4 weeks after illness, still requiring low flow oxygen, out of ICU, at home, how do you manage them? So what I would say, a patient who has dyspnea at 4 weeks, who has hypoxemia or exercise-related desaturation with a CT which has some degree of consolidation in form of organizing pneumonia. So at 4 to 6 weeks, you have two types of CT scans, probably findings. One would be a predominantly organizing pneumonia pattern, and second would be a predominantly a fine fibrotic changes or fine ground glass, which is going into fibrosis. So for organizing pneumonia pattern, I prefer starting the steroids in the dose of 0.5 milligram. And I think everybody does that. The 0.5 milligram to 0.75 milligram. Since this problem of mucor has come, patients as well as physicians are very hesitant in initiating steroids. But I think for these patients who have post-COVID organizing pneumonia, which is not going and causing hypoxemia, correct dose of steroids is at least 0.5 milligram per kg of body weight that should be given and tapered over next 6 to 12 weeks. I don't stop any steroid before 6 weeks if I have started it for a post-COVID organizing pneumonia. And usually it is for 8 weeks that we end up with a dose of 5 milligrams, and by 12 weeks we can stop it. Secondly, cause the issue of antifibrotics in the late phase patients. So I at least don't give an antifibrotic for a patient till 8 weeks recovery, because almost everybody would improve with the steroids to a significant extent. There are very few patients who have a baseline CT at 6 weeks, which shows significant fibrosis. Those are the only patients who may be given a trial, which is like, if you see 100 patients at 6 weeks, almost 40% would fit into the criteria of having some organizing pneumonia or CT, but only 5% of them would fit into the criteria that they have only fibrotic changes at 6 weeks or 8 weeks. So that is the only population which I prefer to give antifibrotics. The reason being, one is side effect profile. Secondly, I don't know whether they work, and I don't know for how long do I give it. But I have given it for patients for 6 months, and I would personally say that I have really not seen any difference in those patients. So I am very reserving about the use of antifibrotics. But if I have to use, I'll use nintedanib as first. But secondly, the correct, I think the only evidence we have is steroid is in AGRCCM1 paper. But steroid in the correct dosage, correct duration is the key for such recovery. And obviously, we'll discuss about the rehabilitation in the next two questions.
Thank you, Praveen, Abhar, and Saurabh. All the three have given excellent opinions. So antifibrotics, as of now, we can't recommend with a high degree of conviction, but probably we need a lot of prospective studies on that. That is number one. Secondly, these are not drugs that act acutely. So probably they require a few weeks for their effect, if any, to come. So you use that rationale, probably someone having high chance of progressing to fibrosis like a severe ARDS, maybe you are justified in upfront starting it at that phase. Beware of the drug interactions, beware of the side effects. So, and how long, we don't know, because it's not probably not a progressive fibrosis like any other fibrotic interstitial lung disease. So lots of lack of clarities on that, but try to generate our own evidence. So my next question has also been partially answered, because my next question was on progression of radiological shadows and fibrosis, and also that has been answered very well by the three panelists, that it's not a progressive fibrosis, it's probably a resolving organizing pneumonia, and sort of staticity of fibrosis, whatever is remaining at the end of 3 months tends to remain for long. Okay. Now, if there is a progressive radiological shadows, do you think of a secondary insult like thromboembolism or secondary infection? And what would be your protocol for follow-up of COVID patients post-discharge, the timing, radiology, lung function measurement, etc., with special emphasis to DLCO? Again, Dr. Saurabh.
Okay, sir. So at least 6 weeks from the onset of illness would be the time when I would be really following these patients on a first follow-up, except the patients whom I have discharged on oxygen and I have to see them in a week after the discharge. But for patients who have gone home off oxygen, I see them at least 6 weeks from the onset of their illness. The first thing which we have to see is the one, whether they have symptoms, which includes cough or the shortness of breath, which is very common, which if you see such patients, almost 60-70% would fit into either of these two symptoms. Then second thing is the baseline hypoxemia or the exertion related, that means 6-minute walk test. So we do 6-minute walk test for everybody at around 6 weeks of follow-up to see the exercise related desaturation. And third thing would be, if patient has any of these, we'll go ahead with a full PFT, means a spirometry with or without DLCO. I'll come to the DLCO issue, and a chest radiograph. And depending upon the chest CT findings, and if there is a restriction on a PFT and a patient has symptoms, then only we go ahead for a HRCT of the chest. Otherwise, we really don't do a CT for a patient who does not have symptoms or hypoxemia or a PFT abnormality. The issue of DLCO is very peculiar. So if you see all the papers coming from the post-COVID, everybody suggests that patients have 70% would have diffusion abnormalities at 2 months, 3 months. So that is really going to stay there. It is really, if you see patients who have a follow-up of 6 months, they still have a DLCO of around 30 to 40%. So diffusion abnormalities tend to persist. But the major problem with DLCO is that I would say a majority of the patients who come are not able to perform the test correctly. And that is the major problem in interpreting the DLCO for first follow-up itself. So if you don't have a baseline, then you can't really compare it with the follow-up. So we really don't do DLCOs for regular follow-ups, but we tend to do it once. If patient is able to do, then we can kind of do it on a follow-ups. But the basic follow-up is with the symptoms, spirometry, and a 6-minute walk test, which we do at 6 weeks. And after that, we do it almost every 3 months. So this is depending upon the patient's baseline parameters. If baseline is normal and patient is fine, we really don't need to repeat it again and again. But if patient has symptoms, we have started him on steroid therapy or antifibrotics, then 6 to 8 weeks follow-up PFT on 6-minute walk test is needed.
Thank you, Dr. Sautam. So it again depends upon the status of the patient when he was discharged. Somebody who was pretty sick enough on oxygen, you would like to see him early. Someone who was reasonably stable, you would like to see him after 4 to 6 weeks. Perfect. Dr. Abar, with your permission, I'm just changing your question, next question, because post-COVID fibrosis and antifibrotics have been discussed a lot. There are a lot of queries that have come up, and I think you would be the best person to take that. There is one query from Dr. Divya. Many hypoxic patients are having moderate to severe PAH when it is evaluated during IP. So what are the therapeutic interventions? Does it require any therapeutic interventions at all?
Very good question. I think this is something which we have to address. And this is something that we are seeing very commonly also, especially cases who are hitting severe ARDS kind of a picture. They do develop PAH, whether it be moderate or whether it be severe. And this is not just associated with PAH. If you look at the echo properly, you will also see right heart dysfunction over there. Very commonly, we see RARV dilation, or there is a dysfunction in the motility of the right ventricle also. So there are multifold reasons to this. One is the severe hypoxemia itself can precipitate the pulmonary hypertension. The changes that we are seeing in the pulmonary vasculature, whether it is because of the perivascular fibrosis or whether it is because of the intimal thickening that the disease persists causing. And then largely because of the embolic disease, because of the de novo thrombosis. I'd not like to call it embolism over here, but de novo thrombosis, which is being caused in the lungs. I think all of these factors together are adding up to the pulmonary hypertension that we are seeing in these COVID ARDS patients. Now, whether or not it needs therapeutic intervention is again a matter of debate. I think treating the cause is the first and the foremost important thing. So if we are maintaining the three most important things that have been shown to work, one is oxygen delivery, whether it is by oxygen supplementation or non-invasive ventilation or ventilation or ECMO. Making sure that the hypoxemia is corrected is most important. Along with that, steroids and anticoagulation. I think this is the most important thing that we have to practice first. Now, beyond that, if there is still persistent pulmonary hypertension, then we can think of adding other drugs like inhaled nitric oxide. In some of the cases, we've seen works very well, especially when patients are intubated. It is very easy to insert that into the ventilation circuit. And for a period of 2 to 3 days, you can use inhaled nitric oxide. You can start with a low dose at 10 ppm and go all the way up to 25, 30 ppm also. I think that is something that can work. Beyond that, I don't think whether interventions such as drugs like sildenafil or ambrisentan are of much use over here because of the etiology of the pulmonary hypertension. And then majorly, we have to rule out clots. We have to rule out major thrombosis, which may be in the main pulmonary trunk or in the right or left pulmonary trunk. So if we are able to identify that, then of course, interventions in terms of targeted thrombolysis is what we are using. Take the patient to the cath lab, float a catheter into the pulmonary artery and do a targeted lysis of thrombolysis rather than just using diffuse thrombolysis, which again causes a lot of issues with cerebral bleed in the patients, GI bleeds in the patients. So targeted thrombolysis is something that we have used and what we have found to work in many of these cases. I think Dr. Rajesh, you're muted.
One more query to you, Dr. Abar. It's from Dr. Usha Devi. She has asked patients without desaturation at rest as well as exercise, but has fever and chest X-ray shows infiltrates. How to proceed? Some patients don't have fever, but they're admitted with other comorbidities. I didn't exactly understand what she meant, but if the patient has no gas exchange consequences, but just symptoms and fever,
as I said, you don't really need to wait for the hypoxemia to set in. If the patient is having persistent fever, if the X-ray is showing infiltrates, that is a sign of inflammation. And I would treat this patient right now upfront with antivirals and also maybe with a low dose of steroid at this point of time. If the antivirals have been given and still this is persisting, then I would definitely raise my dose of steroid to counter the inflammation which is going on. So waiting for the hypoxemia to set in, I wouldn't do that. If there is persistent symptoms, if there is abnormalities on the X-rays, yes, go ahead and treat that.
Thank you, Dr. Abar. One query to Dr. Praveen. Praveen, actually, this is a query from Dr. Ajoy. I think Ajoy is one of the person who actively takes part in all panels and discussions. So the question from Ajoy is, should the steroids be started after the initial viremia phase, say after 5 days, since it can be a double-edged sword if used early, if symptom onset is counted as the day one? So I think no discussion can be completed without controversies on steroids. So Praveen, I think Dr. Abar was of the opinion that probably we should start it early before, at the earliest sign of hypoxia. Yes, I do agree with that. But Dr. Ajoy is specifically asking, if it is within the first day, should we be really scared of starting steroids? What is your take on that?
Okay. If the patient has come in a very sick stage, of course, we don't look for any of these. Okay, if the patient has hypoxia, we had patients who come within 2 or 3 days with hypoxia and all these, and ended up on ECMO. So, of course, we don't wait for all these. But like, say, if the patient was stable at home and, slowly worsening, we don't, that's not, as I think Dr. Abar and Dr. Saurabh has said, we don't look at just the timeline alone. It's not just like a fixed period, say 5 days later, we will start. But at the same time, if the patient has a persistent fever, say 5 or 6th day, then we need to think that the inflammatory phase has set in and, he is going in for significant inflammation. So that will be the ideal time to start on a steroid. Similarly, if the patient has an increasing cough and, increasing myalgia, increasing distress, then I think even without a hypoxia, we should be able to start them on a steroid. But not just because the patient has crossed the timeline, say 5 days, and then we start them on a steroid. So in that case, as Ajoy has said, it would be a double-edged sword. So the chance that we all know that if we give them in a mild disease, then the chance that the patient can worsen is definitely there. So we can wait on that. But if the symptoms are there, definitely we will start on that. We don't wait any longer.
Okay. And one more query from Dr. Smita. I think Dr. Saurabh can take that. If CRP is still high after 2 weeks, should we continue steroids? I don't think she has given the clinical status. She has just mentioned if CRP is still high after 2 weeks, should we continue steroids?
So I would continue from the previous question, the initiation of steroids. So one thing is very, very clear to us from now is that hypoxemia, steroids has to be given, whether day one, day two, day three, day four. But what we count as day two, day three is usually the wrong history or the wrong exposure or the wrong timing of thinking. Most of the times you would end up in an hypoxemia from 4 or 5 days onwards, not before that. So hypoxemia, steroids have to be given. There is no confusion, no doubt, from the 93 or low. The problem is for the milder cases. So for milder cases, I would still keep a timeline that if the fever, which is like 102 or 101, more than 101 after 7 days of illness, then only I would prefer giving steroids. Still day 7 of a mild illness without hypoxemia, I would still manage with anti-inflammatory and paracetamol rather than starting them on steroids. Secondly, the dose of steroid for a hypoxemic versus a mild patient with persistent fever till day 7 or day 8. So for a patient who has hypoxemia, the dose for a moderate patient may be 6 milligrams of dexamethasone per day, or maybe 40 milligrams twice daily of methylprednisolone. For a severe patients, you may need to give sometimes pulse 250 milligrams, or you may need to give 120 milligrams of methylprednisolone or 20 milligrams of dexamethasone. So dose may be higher depending upon the severity of disease. But for milder patients, the dose is usually the low one. That means either dexamethasone of 6 milligrams once daily or a methylpred of 16 milligrams twice daily. Not more than that for a patient who is not hypoxemic, but you are giving an anti-inflammatory agent because of the persistent fever. So probably those, that is the answer to the first question. Secondly, regarding the persistent rise in the CRP. So yes, we are not treating CRP. We are treating the hypoxemia. And if patient has persistent hypoxemia at 2 weeks, we need to continue steroids. If patient's hypoxemia is resolving, we probably need to start tapering the steroids. So that would be my take on that.
Thank you, Dr.
Just one more thing. I think if there is a persistent CRP and if the patient is stable, is not hypoxic, I think we should think of a secondary bacterial infection that is coming in. So we need to watch out for that.
Okay, maybe treat the patient and treat the clinical syndrome, then yes, just treating the lab reports. Perfect.
Yes.
Now, just before the next question, just a word to the organizers. I have three more questions remaining. Can I take another 15 minutes, Thomas Chief?
Yes, sir.
There are three areas that need to be discussed. So, again, come back to Dr. Praveen. Praveen, what is the incidence of secondary infection, bacterial or fungal, in survivors of COVID? And next is the another, you know, landmark question. Your take on the second wave of COVID in India and the huge occurrence of zygomycosis. And what is the probable reason for that? And what is the key to prevention?
Okay. So that's a hot question now. We all know that, the co-infection as well as superadded infections are common in COVID. And of course, superadded infections are much more common in COVID, of course, than a co-infection. And probably the main reason is, of course, the immune deficiency is there. But more than that, many a time, set aside the steroids and the immune suppression that is caused by the patient. And more than that, the humongous number of the patient that we have to cater to the current COVID scenario itself is causing so much of secondary infection, and we are finding it to actually implement the antibiotic stewardship in our ICUs many a time. So that itself is probably another reason, other than the use of the immunosuppressants like steroids, tocilizumab, or any other drugs to causing this. Which is causing the secondary infection. So the most common, like in our ICU, secondary infection that we see is the gram-negative infection, the Klebsiella as well as the Acinetobacter, and that's the most common one. And of course, some amount of gram-positive, especially the coagulase-negative staph and the MRSA and enterococci is also seen. But it's the gram-negative which always predominates. The other set of the non-bacterial ones in India, of course, we do talk of the tuberculosis as a co-infection per se, because the guidelines also talk about that. But said and done, what in a tertiary care hospital like us, the other thing that we see is the fungal infection. It's a huge problem for us, especially the Aspergillus. The zygomycosis, the rhizopus is not, the mucor is not that common in our place, but Aspergillus is there in invariably most of the patient who goes in for a long-term hospitalization, say more than 2 to 3 weeks of ventilator or ventilator stay. Most of these patients will have ventilator or ECMO stay. Most of these patients will have some amount of Aspergillus infection. So the CAPA, that is the COVID associated pulmonary aspergillosis, is pretty common. But of course we need to keep a high index of suspicion, looking at the increase in radiological features, like the hollow cavities, the bronchocentric lesions, etc., in the Aspergillus. And similarly, and it's mostly the Aspergillus fumigatus that we see. The other end of the other fungal infection is what we see is the mucor, the pulmonary mucor mycosis. Not as much as that of the rhinocerebral mucormycosis that we see, but still, pulmonary mucormycosis is also there. And we need to look for the so-called the thick-walled cavities and the reverse halo sign, that is the tall sign or multiple nodules and pleural effusion. We need to, and the progressive lesions, we need to think of an mucormycosis. So both these things are especially the Aspergillus is pretty common in most of our patients. So how to prevent is, there are a few things. These fungal infection primarily predominates in those patients who has some amount of comorbidities, primarily the diabetes. Of course, COVID-19 itself is an immunosuppressive state. The coexisting diseases like diabetes, the CKDs, or the cirrhotic patients, and along with those patients who has received corticosteroids and other immunomodulatory, especially the tocilizumab. So these patients, we need to be watchful about it. And of course, the second thing is the hygiene. Hygiene around the hospital is extremely important, because both these things are seen across in the environment, and especially the mucor is something that very much linked to the hygiene. So hygiene around the hospital is extremely important. So antibiotic stewardship is very, very important. So the key to control these is the control of the hyperglycemia, that is the glycemic status, that is very, very important. Then an early detection of these of the disease and early treatment with liposomal amphotericin, as well as and surgical treatment, is probably the key to treat these patients. So that is the way to prevent it also. That is the control of the hyperglycemia and the good hygiene.
Thank you, Praveen. Yeah. My only other additional points was that COVID is a global phenomenon, whereas mucor is more or less an Indian phenomenon. So probably we are doing something that the rest of the world is not doing to cause COVID. Probably we don't know what really it is. Is it yes, hyperglycemia, but it's not pertinent to just blame hyperglycemia alone. Yeah. I thought high dose steroids, probably more judicious dose of steroids. Probably we have a more humid and moist environment, so yes, more mucor as fungus in the atmosphere. Maybe the steam that we are inhaling, maybe the high flow oxygen cannulas and all the nasal trauma. Who knows? Maybe seeing iron. We don't know. But then probably, as Praveen said, judicious control of glycemic status, judicious use of steroids, be aware of the NDT, try to diagnose at least at a stage where it is restricted to the sinuses. Then that is where the successful treatment comes, rather than when it goes into a cerebral or pulmonary stage. Okay.
Just a small add-on to that, probably as Dr. Rajesh has said, it's more of an Indian phenomenon. So like in our hospital, even though we have treated so many ICU patients, we have never seen, probably in Rajagiri also.
Not much.
Not from inside the hospital. We had patients who has come with mucor, but not exactly from inside the hospital. In our hospital, we never used the humidifier flow meters. Because of the same reason that it can cause these sort of fungal infection. Of course, we do use it if they are on a very high flows, but for a low flow, we never use it. Like high flow oxygen therapies and very high oxygen on an RBM patients, yes, but otherwise we never tend to use this, because this is another reason. As I said, the hygiene is one thing that we need to be very careful about, the way we use the oxygen mask and the cleaning of the oxygen mask and how the staff is keeping these oxygen cannulas and the nasal cannulas, as well as the oxygen mask on the side of the patient. All these probably matters a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Praveen. Very well stated. So we move to the second last question.
I would like to add one point.
Yeah, please.
Yes. So what we talk about the prevention of mucor, because we are seeing a lot of mucor in Delhi at least, and none of them is from our hospital, but we are seeing a lot of, means our wards are full with mucor right now, which are being admitted from the peripheral hospitals. So what I understand is that whatever be the reason it is happening, whether it's the environment or the steroids or the diabetes, but probably the media for that is the glucose. Means I have not seen a single patient out of like 150 who are admitted with us. None of those patients had a controlled blood sugar. So whatever be the additional causative factors that remains there, but if you control the blood sugars, it is not going to happen. That's for sure. So the best way to prevention is control the blood sugar while you are giving steroids to anyone at home or in a small hospital or a large hospital. So okay. That's what might be my concern.
Okay, sir. Message very well pointed out. Okay. And the second last question again to you, Dr. Savarab. The role of pulmonary rehabilitation in post-COVID. How early can you initiate in a person who is recovering from respiratory failure, the feasibility and impact of tele sessions?
So I would say that rehabilitation starts as soon as the patient gets admitted to the hospital. So there will be degree of rehabilitation would vary depending upon the patient's requirement of oxygen or patient's functional status. Means if somebody who's on oxygen and if he can just drink his own water, that's a rehabilitation for him. I have seen patients lying in hospitals or at home and nobody's even touching them and they are just lying in their beds. So early mobilization is what the rehabilitation means. For a patient who is on oxygen, 1 liter, 2 liter, 10 liter or on HFNC, if they can move, they can get up, they can sit with their legs dangling from the bedside and they can just move their limbs, that's good enough rehabilitation for them. So if you see the mild patients of COVID who just had fever, the muscle weakness at 2 weeks is extremely bad, even for those patients who had no hypoxemia. So now we see the degree of weakness for patients who required steroids, high dose pulse steroids, or who had poor control of blood sugars. So rehabilitation has to start from day one. Unless we think of it actively in every patient's bedside, we won't do it. Once you go bedside, you think that how can I mobilize this patient a little better than what he's already doing. Secondly, for patients who have recovered or are being discharged or are in ICU, we do have physiotherapy colleagues who do it every day. And it is for the ICU recovering patients. You can do the active passive training exercises for them. You can do chest physiotherapy in the form of cupping. But the limb physiotherapy is one part which I feel is missing. A lot of videos, a lot of hospitals have now adopted the policy of doing the regular chest physiotherapy, even the smaller ones which were not doing before. But the limb physiotherapy part is still missing in a lot of hospitals. Mobilizing the patient to stand bedside or to walk bedside, those are the things which we need to encourage more often. Regarding the tele rehabilitation in the post-COVID patients, we are also doing it, but the problem is with the, at least in our setting, the understanding of the patients. If you have a patient profile who can very well understand your videos, follow your videos, then that's good enough. But sometimes patients who are poor or living in an environment where they can't really do some exercise or yoga, which we kind of tell them to do. So it all depends upon the patient profile, but telemedicine helps in one, you can assess their symptoms, tele-rehabilitation. You can give them nutritional advice and you can show them the basic muscle strengthening exercise with the telemedicine. And it can go to a larger population rather than 1:1 for a patient.
Yeah.
But obviously the compliance would be poorer than a patient who is done 1:1 to a physiotherapist.
Yeah, just to add on, in fact, we have started a sort of we already had a pulmonary rehab which was going on. To this, we have added a sort of a post-COVID rehabilitation for those patients who started on, you know, as Dr. Saurabh has mentioned, we started as early as possible, especially on those patients who are on ventilators. We start them on as early as possible. So we have a set of sessions, say like a breathing exercises. We do some sort of vestibular exercises. We do some cross body exercises. It's all when the patient is lying on the bed itself, along with some sort of strength building. Strength building is just just starting from yawning to smiling, and all these are strength building exercises. So it's a very simple thing that we think, but that these are the ones which we actually help in. Like say a cross body exercises is nothing but then, you know, he tries to, you know, crawl and touches his in the supine position itself. So these are the simple ones, but then these things are the one which a basic thing that helps in this patient to rehab much better, and probably weaning off from the ventilator will be much better when we start them on and pulmonary rehab.
Yeah, just a couple of things. One, our president of APT, Dr. Thomas, has just raised his hands. Thomas ji?
Yes, Rajesh.
You have just raised your hand. Anything specific you wanted to add?
Any role for stem cell therapy?
No, we are coming to that at the last question.
Okay, then proceed. Nothing.
Okay, and then one word, I think Akhilesh is around. I think he has a case series of published case series of rehab in post-COVID. Akhilesh, you want to mention anything about that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can be brief.
Yes, sir. This sir told, actually, along with this ventilatory training, we need to have limb physiotherapy. Early mobilization is most important, which is mostly missing in most of the cases. If you start early, that will be beneficial. And regarding telerehabilitation also, if the communications and communication skill and the understanding of the bystander who is able to make the patients do, that is also most important in case of telerehabilitation. That's all, sir.
Okay. And last question, before that, there is one question from Dr. Joshua. There are various views when to get a CT scan in COVID patients. What is your latest protocol? Probably in very short, I can say that someone who is very sick, to just know the extent of the disease, may be prognosticated, you can try it out, but then always interpret along with other physiological parameters and other investigations. And then post-COVID state, probably you will delay a CT scan for around 4 to 6 weeks until there is a compelling reason, like you are suspecting a complication like thromboembolism or a secondary fungal disease and all those things. So last question, I think it again goes to Dr. Abar. So you can guess what the question is. So for your views on the indications, feasibility and timing of lung transplantation for post-COVID lung sequelae, and just share your experience also with us.
So that had to come. So I think the indications are very clear over here. So it's not just, you know, lung damage, it's not just fibrotic damage, but lung transplant for COVID has become a very, very specific case scenario. And a beautiful paper from Toronto Hospital by Shaf Keshavji and Marcelo Seppes is out there, which is giving out good points, bullet points that the patient has to follow. So the basic thing is that the age limit has been set to 65, although in the Indian context, we are seeing that patients beyond 50, 52 years of age, they do not do very well in a post-COVID lung transplant scenario. So we are keeping our cutoff between 50 to 55, depending upon the physical condition of the patient. Along with that, the general criteria for transplant have to be fulfilled. That means the patient should be a transplant candidate. Beyond that, patient should have been given sufficient time to recovery, which we are arbitrarily keeping between 4 to 6 weeks. So if the patient is on ECMO and has transferred to ECMO from NIV and from ventilator, so a good 4 weeks or 5 weeks is the time period that we have to give the patient. That means adequate time for recovery has been given. Now, beyond that, the patient has to be awake. He cannot be sedated and paralyzed on the vent and on the ECMO. He has to be conscious enough. He has to be understanding and has to be participating into the discussions about the transplant. The family has to be involved in that. The patient has to be rehabbed. So most of the ECMOs that we are doing as a bridge to transplantation, the patients are being rehabbed even while on ECMO. They're undergoing limb physiotherapy. They're undergoing chest physiotherapy. Although most of these cases, if you see, they're generating a tidal volume of 50, 60 ml. So these are totally ECMO-dependent patients, where the lung is not showing any signs of recovery and is just worsening day by day. The most important thing that we have to maintain these patients, we have to keep them free of bacteremia. We have to keep treating them for different rounds of sepsis with different organisms that we get. And many of these cases, we see that the infection may not be an exogenous infection. There is a lot of endogenous activation of infections in these patients, because the lungs have become bad. They've become sort of petri dishes, which is a storehouse of so many infections that can develop into them. So if all these criteria can be fulfilled, Plus, it has to be done at a center which has sufficient experience with ECMO bridges to transplant, which has a good donor pool. That means your regular waiting list where your ILDs and COPDs are still waiting, because transplantation has not been stopped during the COVID time. It is still going on. So all these criteria have to be fulfilled. And then you can consider a patient as a candidate for transplant for a post-COVID sequelae or post-COVID fibrosis. For my experience, so between the two centers, I had about 20 cases which were transplanted when I was at MGM Hospital, Chennai. And we've done 6 cases after I moved to Yashoda Hospital, Secunderabad. So the overall survival has been great. So as compared to about a 90% success that we see in a regular ILD or COPD, it's slightly low. We are at a 70% survival over here. When I'm talking about survival, I mean, post-operative and a perioperative mortality. So about we've lost a few cases. Who have continued to be on ECMO even after transplant. And there have been cases, the major issue with these patients, even after transplant, is these two. It's not rejection, but it is infection and it is bleeding. Many of these cases bleed profusely post-transplant and during the surgery as well. And that is one of the major reasons why mortality is high in these cases. But overall, across the world, I think we have the largest numbers in India that we have done for a post-COVID transplants now, which is far exceeding the numbers that have been done in the US. In Europe, I think only about Vienna or a few other centers are practicing post-COVID transplants. UK is not doing that. Australia is not doing that. So the total overall experience for post-COVID transplants is very small. Our numbers are growing. The experience is growing. And I think we are getting better. We are understanding the patients. We are able to rehab the patients. We are able to prepare the patients better for the post-COVID transplants here.
One final question to everyone. Thank you, Dr. Abar, for excellent exposition of the post-COVID. Regarding stem cell therapy in post-COVID lung disease, is it feasible? How do we go about it? Any panelist can take. Even Dr. Thomas wanted to put in a few words, I think. Dr. Thomas.
Yeah, I think this stem cell therapy, favorable reports are coming up from China. And already there are case reports for many lung diseases, though the stem cell therapy is standard care for in osteoarthritis and other connective tissue diseases as well. So I don't think it's not practiced in India, but favorable reports are coming up. I think our panelists can add to that.
Anyone can type in?
So, sir, I would like to say that I don't know the answer to this question. One, and what I personally believe that we are not going to find a solution with these stem cells, at least not in the near future time. So rather than looking at the stem cell at the as a cure for regenerating the fibrosing lung for a disease which is very acute, for chronic diseases, we can think of that it may give some time, but like stem cells making a new lung in 4 weeks for a patient who is ECMO dependent or is getting very bad is something which is too much to think about. There may be studies being done or tried the stem cells for early recovery or early healing of patients with COVID, but I think it's still a very long way to get that into the at least into a good clinical trial. They will be very small trials which would be happening. Even getting it to a good clinical trial is a long way.
See, I think case reports are there. They agreed to that. But then the major issue over here is if you look at historical evidence for the use of stem cells also, if we separate out the two pathologies over here, let's talk about ARDS and let's talk about fibrosing illnesses like IPF. So stem cells have been tried in both, and still there is no strong evidence to the support of using stem cells in these illnesses. So by extrapolation, I don't know whether or not it will be helpful for COVID. Personally, I have no experience. I have not used stem cells in any of my patients. I have a much better answer. Those patients can be offered ECMO, the patients can be offered a bridge to transplant. And that is something which we have proven works for these patients. So stem cells, really the answer may be out there, but we still need to grab it.
In fact, I came to know about the stem cell in COVID is after one of our residents' father who got admitted in Vizag. So they told him that, of course, he was in severe ARDS and
he's on Vend and all this, and they told him that stem cell is the only way possible. So that's the time when I in fact heard about stem cell for the first time, and I looked into that. That was say 2 months back hardly. So that's the time when I actually looked into it, that whether stem cell the transplant for COVID. But other than that, I don't have much any experience or any knowledge about stem cell transplant.
So probably we can conclude by saying that none of us are knowledgeable or competent enough to comment on stem cell therapy for COVID right now. And probably we, since we have better options, we will stick on to what we know better. So with that, if everyone allow me, we can call it a day from our panel discussion.
Sir, I think hello, sir. Rajesh, I think there are a few questions in the chat box also.
If we have time, we can take that.
Yeah, I think we will finish that also. I think.
Okay, absolutely. Part. Then thank you so much, Uni.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Now, a few specific worries. I think whatever can be included in pulmonary rehabilitation, that has already been taken up and answered. If patient CT shows possibility of mucormycosis, what is the next investigation? Sputum fungal culture. Okay, anyone can take that.
Yeah, I think if the patient has a CT picture of an mucormycosis, it's basically it's a high index of suspicion. And as I said, how to look at it is it, because it's just worsening infiltrate and worsening saturation. And that's the time when we and if the patient has, not a very high florid CRP and they are not, but still the patient has worsening features. And that's the time when we need to look for any fungal infection, let it be. And as I mentioned earlier, we need to look for those, cavitating lesions, especially in mucor. So if the patient is stable enough, I'll definitely go for a bronchoscopy and send it for a culture. That will be the ideal way forward. Anything else? Because we don't have biomarkers that is available for mucor. I'm talking of mucor. Specifically for mucor, there are no biomarkers. So the ideal scenario will be if the patient is stable enough, I'll definitely do a bronchoscopy and send it for culture.
I think fair enough. Then there is the next question, the use of newer oral anticoagulants in discharge patients and how often do we need to monitor with D-dimer? Think, Dr. Abar?
No, I'm sorry. Can I have that question again?
Okay. Someone is querying, kindly mention regarding the use of newer oral anticoagulants in discharge patients after COVID and how often do we need to monitor with D-dimer?
Again, see, it's a very debatable question. What I would really like to bring out here, D-dimer, CRP, let's not treat the reports. Let's treat our patients. If the patient is not symptomatic, if the patient is doing fine, you don't need to go on testing the patient and prescribing medications just to treat those numbers. Of course, yes, if the CRP is high, if the D-dimer is high, and that correlates with the activity, the patient is still slightly hypoxic, you're sending the patient back on oxygen. There are shadows on the X-ray or there are shadows on the CT scan, which correlate with overall general condition of the patient, then I would definitely send the patient home on some degree of steroids, some degree of oral anticoagulation. And then it would need to continue till the patient becomes symptomatically better. And then maybe a week or 2 weeks after that, there is no clear cut, guideline given out. There's no clear cut duration, which has been spelled out. And the major issue over here is I'd like to repeat myself to say that let's not treat the reports, but let's look at our patient and let's decide on these things on an individual case basis.
The repetitions, except last one, which Dr. Akhilesh has put across, he has come across a lot of cases of pneumothorax, BPF, slow expansion in already fibrotic patients, etc. How does the management differ, if it does differ at all? I think it's more or less the same management of any other ARDS ventilated patients, I suppose. I don't think it really differs from that. So I think most of the other questions are repetitions of what we have done. So I will just like to call it a day by saying that I'm sorry that if we have not answered some of the queries and if we have not able to address specific persons who are there in the delegate list, I'm sorry for that. But I would like to acknowledge the presence and thank the presence of senior consultants of APCCM, including C. Ravindran sir, J. Prakash sir, Dr. Rainis, Dr. Judo, Dr. Murali, Shobha madam, Dr. Krishna Kumar, Dr. Akhilesh, Dr. Ajoy, Dr. Ajay Ravi, etc., etc. And I would like to thank the IMA Thrissur, as well as the APT, Office for Thomas G., Dr. Jansto, Dr. Unni, and others for giving us this opportunity. And I was asked to put up a summary of that, but it is a long time, you know, it will take a long time to put up a summary for that. But just I would like to say that pulmonary rehabilitation is pretty important. Use proper drugs at an early time, including a proper dose of steroids, antivirals early, and antifibrotics plus or minus. And please remember that the problems with COVID doesn't end with the antigen negativity. There is a post-COVID syndrome. So please set up post-COVID clinics, holistic post-COVID clinics. Look at the lungs, look at other systems also, and have holistic teams to take care of your patients fare better. And of course, we have transplant as an option in post-COVID lung failure according to criteria. So I sincerely thank Dr. Praveen, Dr. Abhar, and Dr. Saurabh for making this enlightening, as well as for all the delegates for chipping in with questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Joy, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all for your elaborate panel discussion on this. I thank KP2 for their facilitating this meeting. Thank you all the faculties. Now I invite Dr. Jansto, Secretary KP2 for the vote of thanks. Over to you, Dr. Jansto.
Good evening all. It is my great pleasure to offer the vote of thanks as Secretary of Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur. I'd like to first propose the vote of thanks to Dr. Joy Manila, the President of IME Thrissur, as well as Dr. Gopi Kumar, the Secretary of IME Kerala State Branch, and Pavan Madhusudan sir. I would also like to thank Dr. Thomas Vadakkan, the President of Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur, as well as Dr. Unniyar Baby, the Coordinator of IME AMS Thrissur. Dr. Unni has been behind us since February for the conduct of the session, but we have stalled it for so much months, and I think we got the time only now. And in spite of the post-COVID pulmonary complications, we've had multiple panel discussions, but it has always never been enough. So we can see there was almost 145 members who were there till now, and we have still a good number of people staying back. So it was really a very hot topic, and it was not possible without Dr. Rajesh sir. He readily agreed to conduct this panel discussion as moderator. And none of us actually missed the news or debate on the prime time because of Rajesh sir. If it wasn't for Rajesh sir, as a pulmonologist, I think he would have shined as the anchor of a news channel. He was a perfect conductor of an opera with well-orchestrated panel discussion. And I'd like to thank you from the bottom of our hearts, Dr. Rajesh, for the wonderful panel discussion which we had. Next, I would like to also thank Dr. Praveen Valsalan, sir, the lead consultant at Astromed City, Dr. Abhar Jindal, sir, Dr. Saurabh Mittal, sir, all of whom readily agreed to be on this panel discussion. Abhar Jindal, sir, Praveen, sir, is well known to me. So I guess he could not say no to me. And he's always there in all the news channels. So I don't know how he found the time to be with us today. And he's also busy with his patients at Aster, but still he has agreed to be here. Dr. Abhar Jindal, sir, also a great learning experience and enlightenment to hear you. Dr. Saurabh Mittal, sir, again, a very busy consultant from AIIMS Delhi. I got his contact through a friend of mine. He did not want to disclose his name. And he actually told that you were a very good academician, and I have to reiterate that we had a wonderful time listening to you, sir, and we would be calling you again for our the future sessions. It has been a great learning experience for all of us here, and I would also like to thank all the IMA members, IMA AMS members, the association, the members of the Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur, as well as all the senior members of the Academy of Pulmonary and Critical Care Medicine, as well as the pulmonologists of Kerala, who have all come into this meeting in a large number. And we've had a very lively discussion. With that, I'd like to comment. I'd like to also tell that tomorrow, for 3 days, the Association of Pulmonologists Thrissur is conducting a workshop on mechanical ventilation. I'll try to share the link through the physician club, as well as the IMA. The registration is free, so it will be good for all the physicians, and almost all of us will be benefiting it from the learning from the basic fundamentals of mechanical ventilation. It is over the next 3 days, that is Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 7 to 8 p.m. So I will be sharing the link across to you. With that, I'll call it a day. Thank you, and have a good night.
Thank you, Dr. Jansha Kolanar, for your vote of thanks. There is some few more information. We will be coming out another post-COVID circular talk on respiratory rehab. I will be coming to you again for that topic. After that, day after tomorrow, we will be having another CME on the Kerala government COVID treatment protocol in pediatrics and preparedness for the third wave in children. That is day after tomorrow. I expect you all join with us for day after tomorrow CME on this new guidelines. We are getting prepared for the third wave, which is expected to hit the children below the age of 18 years old. So I thank you all once again, and I call it a day, and the meeting is closed for the close. Thank you very much and good night. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Manjula, sir. Good night.
Good night.